Thank you for downloading and listening to this week's MelVee Video Productions interactive and in-depth Bible study lesson. It is our prayer that it will bless you as you listen and also as you watch.
Greetings, friends. In the name of Jesus, we meet again this week as we study lesson 10. And we are so happy and so excited to begin this lesson again this week. And with me in the studio, we have
Vaughan Fleischer
and
Sure Manyema.
And my name is Richard Ntini. Now, before we begin our lesson study, we need to pray. And could you pray for us, Sure?
Let us pray. Dear Jesus, we want to thank you for the privilege of learning this lesson. We pray that may your spirit be upon us to guide us and lead us in all truths. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. The destruction of Jerusalem. Vaughan.
Yes.
Destruction of Jerusalem. Maybe begin before we begin, let's go to Jeremiah 29, verse 7. And hear what the prophet is saying there in that verse. Could you read for us there, Shaw?
Jeremiah 29, verse 7, mm-hmm. And seek the peace of the city, mm-hmm. whither I have caused you to be carried away captives, mm-hmm. and pray unto the Lord for it. Mm-hmm. For in the peace thereof mm-hmm. shall ye have peace.
Amen.
Vaughan, just this verse only, what do you take from it? Because I don't understand the Lord. The Lord takes the Judah into exile. Mm-hmm. And he says to them, when you are here, pray for this country, pray for this city. What does he say?
Well, brother, from what I've picked up here for myself is something we were talking about earlier, mm-hmm. and that's the idea of being content. It's mm-hmm. not about being happy. Mm-hmm. It's about finding peace in the situation where you are. And what God's trying to teach his people here is, listen, this is not a good situation. Mm-hmm. It's not the best situation that I wanted for you. Mm-hmm. But out of this, you're going to learn something. And I need you to find peace here mm-hmm. so that into the future, you will find a greater peace, a greater understanding of my involvement with you as a people.
Now, God has caused Judah to go into exile. Oh. And I realize that he is using Babylon as an instrument. How can that be? Sure. That God can use the so-called enemy as his instrument.
I think God is sovereign.
Yeah.
So, you know, his purposes will be fulfilled. He decides what tools he's going to use. But ultimately, his purpose for us is for us to begin to see him and to seek him again.
Yeah.
And wherever he takes us captive or whatever situations he takes us in, he means good through those situations. So we see here even Judah in exile that God is trying to teach them a lesson to seek him again and to look for his face. Mm. So it doesn't matter what situation we are in and what instrument God has used to bring us to a situation. God wants us to seek him and to find his face again.
If I can mention something, Brother Ntini, yes, the word you used there was cause. God caused Judah to basically get into trouble.
Yeah.
There's this ideology out there that we serve a judgmental, destructive God who causes pain and suffering.
Yes.
If we read the whole part leading up to this, uh-huh. God is speaking to his people uh-huh. at various intervals, trying to get them to stop, change your way. Mm. God didn't cause this to happen. Mm. God allowed it to happen because his people weren't listening to what he was trying to teach them on. So I believe for myself, especially in my family, in my church, I tried to help people understand God doesn't cause pain. God allows something to happen because of my own disobedience.
Yes. So in other words, when we equate to our situation, we would say Babylon is like the devil.
Yes.
That the Lord actually allows the devil to do certain things especially his people, so that they come to their senses. So he doesn't cause, but allows the devil to do something. We are reminded of Job, where Job is an upright man, a man who. But there is a lesson there when you look at the life of Job. that the God is allowing the devil to do something. Because even the devil says, how can I touch him when you have such protection around him?
I think it just reminds me of Galatians 6, verse 7 to 8. You know, be not be deceived, God is not mocked. For whatsoever a man soweth, that he also shall reap.
Yes,
if
you
sow to flesh, you reap corruption. Mm. But if you sow to the Spirit, we are going to reap everlasting life.
Mm.
So our choices, you know, give us the result.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever we choose, if we choose disobedience, God has given us already what the results are going to be. So our choices in our lives become very important. You know, are we choosing for God? Are we living for God? So as we are going to see what becomes of Judah, we can see the results of choices. So we must be careful as we make choices, that we make those choices that really are in tandem with the will of God. And God will give us everlasting life.
One thing that I sort of touched me also is that when God is allowing these to come to us as Christians, allowing these chastisements, if I may call them that way, is that God does not bring a whole ton of bricks upon his people. He brings them in small doses, all the time, in between, talking to you, telling you that if your situation can only get better if you obey obey my commands.
Amen.
But if you don't, this is what is going to happen. You don't listen after that, he brings a bigger and more severe punishment. And so it's an incremental. So all the while, God is trying to talk to you as his child, that you may come back to him and obey his commandments.
Brother Ntini, what's interesting is the first time God deals with chastisement is actually Genesis 3.
Yes.
Where he actually resolves the situation between Adam, Eve, and Lucifer.
Yeah.
And even there, even though he's just told them, listen, this is what is going to happen to you, immediately he gives them a hope.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And this is also what we can find in the scripture. There is a hope. This is the situation, but there is a hope. I need you to see beyond the situation.
Mm-hmm.
And even though Adam and Eve had to face death, there was the hope of life through Christ into the future.
Mm-hmm.
So God never leaves us hanging.
And then now we transcend. Now we are in Babylon, okay? Mm. And God also raises another prophet there, who is Ezekiel. Yeah. And we are also going to learn about the children of God there, Judah. They are sort of weeping for this God who is called Tammuz. Who is Tammuz? Sure.
So if you read about Tammuz, Tammuz is one of these fertility related gods. And I think if we just read the book of Ezekiel, chapter 8, you can see there, even before we go to the children of Israel weeping for Tammuz, there are many other sins that are mentioned there.
Yeah.
And I just want to emphasize the progression of the sins.
Mm.
God starts by telling people to go and look at the northward gate, and there they are images. We see again in the next verse, the Israelites in secret chambers worshiping God. And each time God speaks about their abominations, he says, wait and see, you know, there are bigger things to come. And we can see a progression of the sinners doing their abomination even further and further into the temple of God.
Yeah.
And I think when leaders start to sin, because we start with the 70 elders, the ancients, when leaders start to sin, it opens up the gateway for others to sin. So when we get to women weeping for Tammuz, these are the general population. We have now caught on to this attitude of sin.
Yes.
And they've become so brazen that they can do it even in the temple of God.
So in other words, the people of God are now worshipping a heathen God.
Yes.
And instead of worshipping this thing out of the temple, as Shaw says, they have actually brought Tammuz into the temple.
Yes.
And we also see that Tammuz is an idol.
Yes.
As being an idol that is being worshipped.
Yes.
But we also see here that we are not different from Judah or Israel, if I may say. We're not different at all. We see that the same way they were worshipping idols. It's the same way we are now all worshipping. We have our own idols, by the way. Yes. We have all our own tammuzes, by the way. Mm. And we are warned here in Romans 1, verse 22 to 25, if you can read it for us, somebody, if you can find it. Romans 1, verse 22 to 25.
Romans 1.
1. I like the tenor of the Bible itself there.
Okay. Romans 1, verse 22
to 25. Yeah.
Professing themselves to be wise, they become fools.
Yeah.
And change the glory of the uncorruptible God into an image made like a corruptible man, and to birds, and four-footed beasts, and creeping things.
Yes.
Wherefore, God also gave them up to uncleanliness through the lust of their own hearts to dishonor their own bodies between themselves.
Yeah.
Who changed the truth of God into a lie and worshipped and served the creature more than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen.
Goodness me. You see that what we are doing as Christians of today now, we are worshipping the created things more than the Creator himself.
Yeah.
We also see that the Christian of today is we have our own idols, which could be money, which could be the things that perish,
our jobs,
our cars, our
fashion,
all those things are idols of today.
Definitely.
And woe unto us, because Romans is warning us that we are worshiping these things that are creatures more than the Creator himself.
Yeah.
As we continue on to the unhappy reign of King Zedekiah, would you take us through Vaughan?
Well, basically, if we look at the study material, Zedekiah takes over from the previous king.
Yeah.
And immediately, he is in conflict to Jeremiah.
Yeah.
Where Jeremiah gives advice, and unfortunately, Zedekiah just doesn't want to accept the advice.
Yes.
The problem is that what Jeremiah gives isn't based on Zedekiah and who he is.
Mm-hmm.
It's based on what the people have been doing through two kings before him.
Yeah.
I mean, if we go all the way back to Manasseh and we build up from there, Josiah was the last true good king, and then we've got two bad kings, and then it's poor Zedekiah. And so Jeremiah's message wasn't just about Zedekiah, it was about a people and a way of life.
Mm-hmm. You want to say something?
I was going to say, I think what's interesting about the reign of Zedekiah is that he actually started off with an attitude of wanting to listen to God.
Yes. Mm.
But as he progresses in his reign, he becomes actually afraid of the princes, and he ceases to listen to Jeremiah because he's afraid of what his princes think. And I think the lesson there is, woe unto that man who finds comfort in listening to other men and forsaking the word of God. So we need to make a choice here. What advices do we take?
Mm.
Do we take the word of God? Do we take the word of men? And we can see the disaster that became of the reign of Zedekiah because he chose to listen to what his princes were saying and was afraid to stand for what God was saying.
There comes a time when God must speak to you. And when he speaks to you as an individual and you are convinced that this is the Lord that has spoken, but you go and consult friends, family, and sure is the sun will rise tomorrow.
Yeah.
Human beings have a tendency to take you away from the goal of true worship.
Another interesting point is that Zedekiah decides to make an alliance with Egypt to once again try and save himself instead of trying to make an alliance with God and for ourselves. How many times don't we end up making alliances with people, with financial institutions,
instead
of turning our eyes onto God and making an alliance with God, trusting our finances, our family, our jobs in the hands of the one who originated it, rather than one who's going to charge you interest?
The problem that I have found with men is that they want things that they understand.
Yes.
They want things that are tangible, that only God. Sometimes when God speaks to you and he impresses something into your heart, that thing sometimes cannot be understood by mere men.
Okay.
And then you turn to someone else to try and understand or to help you understand what God has told you. We forget that God is sovereign. Sometimes he will say things that cannot be understood by mere men. Yeah. And so you want to find comfort in other men.
Mm.
And men will always tell you that this is impossible.
Yeah.
God cannot tell you this. And so because of that, you start wavering. You start doubting the word of God.
Yeah.
And this is the way of human beings. And so it continues even from then until now.
Yes,
sure.
Yeah, so if you read 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 3, paraphrased, it speaks about a time when people will bring up teachers for themselves, who will give them teachings that they are like, their ears itch for false teachings.
Mm.
So you can see even in Zedekiah's time that the message of Jeremiah was not accepted. They would rather have prophets that would say things that were in accordance with what they wanted to hear.
Yeah.
So when Jeremiah says, Jerusalem is going to fall, they say, no, we'll seek alliances with
Egypt.
Yes. But when God speaks, it doesn't matter how much we like or dislike what he says, his word will come to pass.
Yes.
And we do well to listen to God and make God our trust and our pillar, so that he can have mercy upon us.
It's not really amazing that Jeremiah got this treatment from his countrymen, because as you will also see that Jesus says a prophet is not without honor, but in his own country and among his own kin and in his own house. What happened then is still happening today.
Yes.
Because even if you try and warn your people, you try and warn your household, you try and warn your own kith and kin, you always find adversity, because the Lord, the word of the Lord, when it comes to you and you accept it, other people, because they do not understand your relationship with God, will always think that you are not telling the truth.
Mm.
People always want to hear that which they want to hear.
Yeah,
yeah. You know, it's you always find that as Jeremiah faced this onslaught from without and from within, because his word was against what the people wanted to hear. So as we continue now, we also see the fall of Jerusalem. Shaw, could you take us through the fall of Jerusalem?
Yeah, so when we look at the fall of Jerusalem and the sad ending of Hezekiah, Zedekiah, we can see there how Jeremiah had given him options to say, you know, if you surrender to the Babylonians,
yes,
you are going to live.
Yes.
But if you don't, this city will be burnt down, it will be destroyed, you are going to be killed. And he makes choices.
Mm.
I think it's the same with us in our lives. You know, God has allowed us to finish the stories of our lives. Our outcomes, whether they are for eternity or for destruction, God has given us enough information to make those choices. And we see here a sad decision by Zedekiah to make decisions for destruction.
Mm.
When God has said, I've set before you life and death, make your choice. And sad to say, even today, God through his word says to us, here is a choice. Life and death, and we still find ourselves choosing death.
I like the way you put it, in that you say we write our own destiny.
Amen.
You write your own destiny, because the Lord has put it plainly on a plate. And here Zedekiah is given a choice, and he's told surrender.
Yeah.
But because he felt that it was a bit difficult for him to surrender, he would rather go and form alliances.
Yeah.
But the word of the Lord still stands. Surrender and be saved.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Vaughan?
For me, there's two ironies here. One is that King Zedekiah flees, and where is he captured? He's captured on the plains of Jericho.
Mm-hmm.
And I just find it interesting that on the very Jericho where through worship a city was destroyed and God was glorified, on that same, the man who had now been worshipping destruction, Baal, etc., was caught once again on this this plain where there was this victory for God.
Yeah.
He was lost.
Yeah.
And the second irony is where the captor of Jeremiah looks at him and starts stating, for me, I just made a byline for myself, a foreigner stating the truth concerning the reason for Jerusalem's destruction. It's just so ironic that this pagan sees the truth.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And those who knew God could not see
it
the
failed
truth.
To see it.
Yes.
It failed to see it.
So God is not a respecter of persons.
No.
God can reveal himself to God reveals himself to those that want to hear him.
Yes.
Yeah. Whether you're an unbeliever or a believer, yes, God will reveal himself only if you let him reveal himself. We also see that, sometimes there are people who are called by his name. People who are called by his name, like Judah was. But because they closed off their ears, they did not even listen. God, though he speaks through Jeremiah, they still don't want to listen.
Yes.
And it is the same thing today. You find that there are Christians who are preaching the truth. But people will say, no, that truth is too hard.
Yeah.
Why don't you tone down? Because people don't want to hear the truth. And we find this happening even today. All your heart, sure.
All your heart. Mm. So I like the fact that when you read the book of Jeremiah, he is a prophet of the heart religion.
Mm.
We read scriptures like Jeremiah 17, verse 9. Mm. The heart is deceitful above all things. Who can know it?
Mm.
We read Jeremiah 13, verse 23. Can an Ethiopian change his skin?
Mm.
Or the leopard change its spot? Then may you also do good that are used to evil. Jeremiah 24, verse 7. And I'll give them an heart to know me,
mm-hmm,
and I am the Lord. Jeremiah 31, 33, the famous one.
Yeah.
God promises a new covenant. I will put my laws in their hearts,
mm-hmm,
and in their inward parts, and write it in their hearts,
mm-hmm,
and I'll be their God, and they shall be my people. Mm. So God opens the door, for us to continue to seek him. And what he's looking for is not an outward religion,
yes,
but a heart religion.
Mm.
So we see even with Judah being taken into captive, God still gives them a promise. This is, maybe let's read this one.
Yeah.
In Jeremiah 20, 29, and on verse 13. This is after the famous verse that we know. I know the thoughts that I have for you. God says, and you shall seek me and find me when you search for me with all your heart.
Yes.
And I think this really is a merciful God.
Yes.
We have done badly. God has, his justice has come upon us, and he still comes back and say, even after I have chastised you, you can seek me with all your heart and you find me. This is the God, the loving God that we serve.
Well, what really touched me about this lesson of the heart is that God seeks repentance first, mm-hmm, before there is any restoration. But the Christian of today wants restoration before repentance.
Yeah.
If you remember the lessons from way back about Jeremiah, where the people were praying and fasting, God looks into their heart and says, "No, they are not repenting because they want to obey. They are repenting because there's thirst in the land.
Yeah.
There's no water in the land.
Yeah.
So God sees what is in our hearts, and what God needs more from us is obedience.
Amen.
He needs repentance. Then God can restore us. Vaughan, what do you get from Wednesday there?
For me, it goes over what I teach at the children's class, and that is, we've all got cell phones and phone numbers.
Mm-hmm.
God's got a phone number.
Yeah.
Jeremiah 33, verse 3, which says,
yeah,
call unto me, and I will answer thee, and I will show thee great and mighty things which thou showest, knowest not.
Mm.
Yeah.
So whenever I work with the children, I show them, look, even God's got a telephone number, and you can call on him, and you can, and he will answer you. And this is what comes out of here. We were talking about all our heart. And we are men, we have wives. When I come to my wife with all of my heart, there's no deception. I'm not trying to mislead her.
Mm.
And I'm honorable in the way that I want to converse with her or the direction that we want to follow.
Mm.
God sees our heart. He will know very quickly if we are being honest in the way that we come to him.
Mm. Mm. We also see that sometimes there's what they call cheap grace these days. Of course, God is graceful. God has given us his grace. But there is this one thing that is cheap grace, which we see here in Jeremiah. The false prophets are saying, oh, yeah, we're going to go to Babylon and we'll only be there for 2 years.
Mm, yeah.
And yet, what is Jeremiah saying? How many?
70 years. 70 years.
So it was very difficult for people of God to accept that. How can we, how God is not like that.
Yeah.
We hear these stories even today. God is not like that. God cannot burn his people. God loves, you know, he's a God of grace. Yes, yeah. He is a God of grace. Yes. But if we are not obedient, the truth of the matter is,
yeah,
all of us will be destroyed. Yeah. This is the message from Jeremiah. Sure.
Yeah. So we see hope even, yes, in disappointment.
Yes.
That even though God is sending them into captivity, they still hope.
Mm.
And this is the God that we worship. Things might be tough because of our own making, but God still gives us hope beyond our present situation.
Mm.
And so we see when we read in Jeremiah 29 that God still promises that you are going to come back.
Yes.
I'm going to restore my people,
yes,
again.
Yes.
And I think that hope is important. There could be someone out there, you know, where things are looking so gloomy that you can't see beyond today.
Yes.
God is saying there is still hope. There is still hope even in that situation. He still loves us and he still has good plans for us even going forward.
Let's go to Jeremiah 29 and hear what the Lord is saying here. Jeremiah 29, verses, maybe let's try from verse 1 and touch a few verses there up to verse 14, time allowing.
Yeah.
Can you read, Vaughan?
All right,
verse 1.
Reading from the King James Bible.
Yes.
Now these are the words of the letter that Jeremiah the prophet sent from Jerusalem unto the residue of the elders which were carried away captives, and to the priests, and to the prophets, and to all the people whom Nebuchadnezzar had carried away captive from Jerusalem to Babylon.
Mm-hmm.
After that, Jeconiah, the king, and the queen, and the eunuchs, the princes of Judah and Jerusalem, and the carpenters and the smiths were departed from Jerusalem.
Mm-hmm.
By the hand of Elasa, the son of Shaphan, and Gamariah, the son of Hilkiah, whom Zedekiah, king of Judah, sent unto Babylon to Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, saying, Thus saith the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, unto all that are carried away captives, whom I have caused to be carried away from Jerusalem unto Babylon. If I can just mention, he says, it's me.
Yeah.
Listen, don't be misled.
Yeah.
My God.
Yeah.
I'm involved here. I'm the one that has caused this.
Yes.
Yeah. No misleading here.
Yeah.
Wow.
Build ye houses and dwell in them, and plant gardens and eat the fruit of them. Take ye wives and beget sons and daughters. Take wives for your sons and give your daughters to husbands, that they may bear sons and daughters, that ye may be increased there and not diminished.
In other words, he's saying you are going to stay there for a long time.
You're going to be there for a while.
For a while.
Yes.
Yeah. Build houses.
Yeah.
Stay in them.
Yeah.
Have children.
Yeah.
Because you are there for a long while.
Yes.
And it is me who has caused this.
Yeah.
So we see that the hand of the Lord is everywhere.
Amen.
Whether you are carried away into the unknown, the hand of the Lord still is everywhere.
Yes.
Now the 70 years. Just explain to us the 70 years, Shaw.
So I think maybe before I explain the 70 years, God is really saying, whatever I have caused to happen, just relax there.
Relax.
Relax there.
Yeah.
But there is hope.
Yeah.
Because I will come again.
Yes.
So in verse 10 of Jeremiah 29,
yes,
it says, For thus saith the Lord, that after 70 years be accomplished at Babylon,
yeah,
I will visit you and perform my good word toward you,
yeah,
in causing you to return to this place. So God does not leave them hopeless.
Yes.
70 years might seem long,
mm-hmm,
but we know when we read in the Old Testament, the Bible refers to the 70 years where the land was supposed to lay fallow.
Mm.
So when we look at the abominations in Judah, that land was supposed to be cleansed.
Yes.
It was supposed to rest from their sins. So God was baking something good for them so that when they come back again,
yes,
they have a new beginning.
Yes.
A new beginning with him. But they had to seek him to have that new beginning with him.
I like in verse 7 of Jeremiah 29, where it says, And seek the peace of the city where I have caused you to be carried away captives, and pray unto the Lord for it. For in the peace thereof ye shall ye have peace.
Amen.
In other words, wherever you find yourself in,
yeah,
whatever situation you find in, pray to the Lord that the Lord makes that situation,
amen,
favorable for you.
Amen.
In other words, when God puts you somewhere, he doesn't just put you and dump you there. God still knows that you are still his people. That's where grace comes in.
Yeah.
In other words, whatever situation you find yourself in as a Christian today, God is still present in that situation.
Mm.
And sometimes you find that even when you are carried away into lands where life can be very difficult for you. What I want to say to you is that as an exile, your captors always will find a fault in you for the situation that they find themselves in.
Yes.
But however, the Lord is saying, pray
for
your captors.
Yeah. Make a difference.
Make a difference wherever you are.
Yeah.
As we come now to the end of this lesson, show your last words.
God is merciful.
Yes.
God is good. I mean, the culmination of the destruction of Judah that we see here.
Yeah.
Jeremiah had been preaching for 40 years
mm-hmm.
through 5 kings. He had been sharing the same message of reform and revival.
Yes.
And people were not listening.
Yeah.
But even then, as they are taken into captivity,
mm-hmm.
God still says, I have good plans for you.
Yes.
You must seek me.
Mm.
So it doesn't matter how long God has been following us and we've been denying him.
Yes.
Even as we go through difficult circumstances because of our own making,
mm.
God still says, I have good plans for you. I have hope for you.
Amen. And Vaughan?
Well, I want to end off with a scripture which comes from John 14, which is that promise that that Christ gives us. And I believe maybe our viewers out there, maybe some people are without work. Maybe there's problems between husbands and wives. And Jesus tells us, let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. Mm-hmm. In my Father's house are many mansions. Mm-hmm. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. The promise for our viewers and for us is that God has not forgotten us. He is coming. He is coming to fetch us, and he is taking us to a better place.
Amen. Yeah.
I just want to say to you viewers is that despite and in spite of your situation, wherever you are, God is still present.
Amen.
God knows your situation.
Yeah.
And God has promised that in spite of your situation, I am there with you. All God is asking of us is that we obey his word.
Amen.
We thank you for having joined us this week. And as we pray now, we pray that the Lord also will bless you. Vaughan, could you pray for us?
Sure. Let us close our eyes. Heavenly Father, as we come before you and we consider this week's lesson, we realize that around us, Jerusalem is falling and we have many challenges. But we need to take heart in a God that has not forgotten us, who has made us a promise that you are coming to fetch us. And even now, in our present situation, through the Holy Spirit and the angels which attend, you are caring for us. You are protecting us. Lord, we thank you for our time together. We pray for each viewer and for us as well, that our hope will always remain in you, that we will never look to the world. In Jesus' name alone, amen.
Amen. Amen.